Aster Gardens project. And I am just amazed at, he's probably the most creative technical person I've ever met in my life. He's got incredible heart and passion for caring for people, and that's demonstrated in his ownership of the Aster Gardens as well as Optima Living. And so he has a real passion for helping people just really enjoy the aging process and to make it be the best years of our lives. And so somehow he's made me not afraid of aging as I've gotten to know him. So that's been really cool. So, well, except for now, the reality of our aging is going to show, as you know, we can't get our hair done. And so anyway,
but you had a good idea yesterday.
So, I have a fabulous idea. And you know what, just before we dive into it, I'm going to share my idea. I actually phoned one of my friends, his son's girlfriend is a hairdresser. And I said, I know she's getting bored out of her mind. So I said, we have this problem. We have these, and I had a friend, Cynthia, she was just sharing kind of she was looking at YouTube videos. How do you color your hair? How do you get it cut? And so she's laughing. So, and it looks fabulous. So basically what we're suggesting is, instead of saying, I can't cut your hair, that you contact all of your clients as a hairdresser and say, let me coach the person in your life who is isolating with you, and I will drop off the product for your hair color, and now we'll put it on FaceTime, and I'm going to walk them through what to do. So you're just not the hands. So he's like, I have to hang up right now and call her. So he hung up quickly to tell her this exciting news that she could still be a coach hair cutter. So anyways, but yeah, it's just, we do life differently now. So that's super exciting. So with that being said, Ali, why don't you just share a little bit about, you know, what you do, and then, you know, what we're talking about is quality of life. And, you know, and I'll just say this, before we were all taking this serious, Ali was taking this very serious. Optima Living has 11 properties, and they're not seeing COVID in them. And part of it is because they were jumping the curve way, I'd say late January probably, but you can tell us a little bit more about that. So there you are. Let's go ahead and...
thanks very much. So like I said, my name is Ali Shivji, and I'm one of the owners of Optima Living. And in my role with Aster Gardens, you know, my title is kind of the Chief Quality of Life Officer. And, you know, take that really seriously, because it's really about how do we create the best possible quality of life for individuals, regardless of where they live or what they do, but how do we engage with that? And I think as an organization, we've spent a lot of time and effort thinking through, you know, the care and the well-being of our residents, but also then how do we get ahead of and try to anticipate everything that we can in order to again, look out for the ones that we love. And, you know, I have a saying that I like to say with my teams, and I said, look, unfortunately I have some good friends that are firefighters, and they're amazing. And my kids particularly love them, particularly when my daughter got stuck in an elevator, but that's a story for a different day. But I say to my teams that, look, unfortunately, very few of us are good looking enough to be firefighters. So we have to anticipate, and we have to work. We have to work ahead of the game, and we have to think through things, because, you know, if we're always firefighting, if we're always trying to just kind of handle the basic things that happen every day, we're not thinking through the bigger, you know, the bigger topics and the bigger issues. And this idea of kind of quality of life, and regardless of if you're isolated right now or you're in a facility or otherwise, you know, we've been trying very hard to say, if you're within an Optima environment or an Optima community, you know, how do we create the right environments? You know, we started almost a month ago now, kind of limiting essential visitors and doing a full screening on everyone that comes through or enters any one of our communities. We've been very proactive with families, and both messaging on our website as well as kind of like overall, and even with our staff, we've been really starting to engage them on how do you think through best practices. And I think one of the things that's also important to understand is that you know, outbreaks of any sort are not new to care facilities or to, you know, retirement living or rather just congregate living in general, because you have, like, you have the flu or you have the cold or other things that come through on a regular basis. And so we're actually very well trained at handling outbreak situations. What I think is different about COVID is that Traditionally, we are very good at handling outbreak situations with just our residents, and we know how to isolate them, we know how to engage them, we know how to have a good quality, you know, manage their quality of life. What's a little bit harder is when you have visitors that may bring the virus, right? And usually, it's a resident that you've identified, you know how to deal with, and you handle it from that perspective. It's almost like what's in front of you, you're not always prepared for what's behind you, i.e. when a resident or, sorry, a staff member, not a staff member, but a visitor comes in. So we've been working really hard at making sure that even that part is that we're very aware of. And thankfully, you know, we haven't had any sort, you know, any kind of positive outbreak, you know, COVID cases in any of the facilities or communities that we run across the country. But that being said, you know, we can't always control what happens, but what we can control is people's quality of life and how we engage with that. And that's really where we try to focus our time and effort.
Hang on, there we go. Thank you so much. So tell me a little bit, just as we're all in isolation, and obviously you're seeing that with seniors as well in the residence. So what is the importance of keeping routines in our lives? Like, do we just kind of completely just go, it's Saturday every day, or how does that work?
Yeah, I know. Look, I think that's a really good question. And I think if we think through the topic today, which is around like, how do you thrive during isolation times, right? I think the first thing is that we need to almost think through what is the regular routine that we would follow, and how do we continue to keep that? Regardless of what is happening around us, it's really important that you have routine. It's really important that you're just like every day when you get up and you shave or you shower and you kind of get ready for work or you get ready to do your activities, you get ready to meet people. It's important to continue that sort of routine, both from a mental, you know, strength and health perspective, but also from a physical perspective, right? When you get up and you shower, when you shave, when you do other stuff, like your body is already kind of, you know, getting itself ready for what a full day would be. And I think that, you know, there's different ways to think through how you set up a routine, and happy to kind of think through maybe what are some specific questions that, that, you know, we've started to ask our loved ones, including my parents or our families, about, you know, what goes into their day that we can help them with the routine. Because the word routine is not that easy. You know, for some of us who are working on a day-to-day basis, the word routine is something that's very natural. But, you know, for a lot of seniors and people at home today, the word routine is not necessarily a word that they're familiar with, not in the context of a definition, but in the context of what it really means. And so I think sometimes it's helpful to say, well, how do we help you set up some sort of schedule which aligns you with the people and the activities that you love the most? And how do we start to help you just answer a couple of questions that may help you get there? And then also to realize that just as much as you may be feeling isolated, there are many, many people out there who are feeling just as isolated. So how do you now start to reach out to those that you love and your friends? And how do we help you think through that part? So I'll stop there, Karen, and please then feel free to kind of poke and dig where you'd like, and I can kind of go into more detail. But I didn't
know. So a couple of things. So yesterday I heard there's a notice, let's say on Costco, saying, please only come if you have to buy essential items, because people are, you are allowed to go shopping, so they're going shopping, but they're not necessarily shopping for things that they need just because they need to get out. So is that part of routine, going shopping?
So, yeah, interesting. I guess what I would say is, if we look at the essence of what you're trying to do there, right? So part of the routine is incorporate certain things into your daily lifestyle, into every single day. You should have, you know, physical activity. You should have engagement with others in some sort of meaningful capacity. You should have your health and your nutrition and your hydration. You know, you should have periods of down and up. You should have periods of mental stimulation. There's all these different things that I think are really important to incorporate into every day. And the way to simply ask yourself the question is, if you were to define your best day, what would it include? Hmm. And, you know, think through that and think of whatever that may be for you. And then once you've understood that, then break it down into, okay, what are the elements of those things? You know, if visiting a museum was one of those things, or or maybe the skydiving was one of those things. It doesn't really matter. But if you think through those first, then you can then think about ways that you can engage with it. So coming back to your question, is shopping part of a routine? So what I'd say there is, there are two elements of that that are important. One is social engagement, right? And engaging with others and being kind of with others. And the second is some sort of physical activity. And so I'd say both of those should be very much part of your routine. But you have to, at this point in time, you have to then add on the layer of COVID. And you have to add on the layer that, maybe the other layer you have to add on is empathy, because you have to also put yourself in the shoes of others. And those who are coming to those places to quickly buy essentials, one, maybe caring for people who are in a very physical, fragile state. And if any of us were to spread that virus or do stuff, we are putting other people at risk. The second thing is we're putting ourselves at risk, because we know that this virus is highly, highly contagious. And we also know that it's not predictable what effects it will have and on each person. And because of that, although I'm not a clinician, there's a lot of stats on this. And even if you were to go to our Aster Gardens website, I know that we're kind of publishing regular materials on COVID on a regular basis and FAQs. And I know we've been engaging kind of Dr. Wag from the University of Alberta on, you know, these topics. But I would say that overall, when you're thinking about that, I think it's really important to come back to, yes, find ways to do social activity and physical activity, but don't involve or don't compromise yourself or others by getting so close to them that you're putting others, yourself at risk, and find other ways to do that than to go shopping at Costco or otherwise, at least for right now.
Yeah, that's good. It's hard to stay positive most days, right? Like there's a lot of emotions that we're dealing with. And I think underlying is an incredible sense of grief, that there's so much loss every day. There's an awareness of further loss that we're encountering. So I was talking to my mom on Sunday, and she did porch deliveries of some cinnamon buns that she made for all of her kids. And it just about ripped her heart out to just have porch waving at her kids. I'm seeing, my grandchildren are far away. We're doing a lot more FaceTime. I can't see them. And a part of me goes, is it easier to have them far away than it would be to have to go and wave at them out the window and not actually be able to touch them? So there's just an enormous pain and loss every day of another new thing that we encounter that we've lost. So how do we pull up out of some of those deeply grievous moments that we have every day?
Yeah. There's no question that there's loss. There's no question that this is difficult and that it is causing a lot of hurt and pain and difficulty for many people. And I think it's important to acknowledge that and just, you know, acknowledge it for what it is, which is a situation that will hopefully pass. And in this short period of time, it's going to create some difficulty. It's going to create some hardship. But there's also, just if you can look at Mother Nature as a great example of the fact that there's a lot of trees that need to be burnt down in order to restart. There's the phoenix, for those of you who kind of are familiar with anything from that perspective, who kind of comes out of the ashes. And there's always a silver lining to all these things that I think we have to understand. But I think the ultimate question that you can start off with here is to say, well, you could decide to hand deliver those cinnamon buns and give your kids a hug. You could decide that, right? Like we are all able to decide those things. But the question is, what's the risk associated with it? And are we comfortable and are our families comfortable with the risks that come out of that? And I think that's the reason we're making some of these decisions, because we're trying to handle or we're trying to put some of those risks, we're trying to mitigate some of those risks because we understand that there's some difficulty. So if you put that aside for a bit and say, look, it's a short period of time that requires us to just think about it differently. And I think if we start there and we say, okay, if we were to look at our lives today versus, let's say, 3 months ago, just to make sure that we've got past almost anyone thinking through the COVID world. 3 months ago, ask yourself, if you were to list down on a sheet of paper the top 10 people that you care about most, you know, your loved ones, your friends, whoever, and it doesn't have to be someone you talk to often, but, you know, what would be the top 10 people that you cared about most? And then honestly ask yourself, in a regular week, in a regular month, how many times are you in touch with those people? And in what way? Is it a phone call once a week, once a day? Was it a, you know, was it a sitting down and watching a movie once? Like, whatever it is, think about that. And then think a little bit about, one, how often can you engage with them now, and is there a way to do so? And I think that it's really important for us to step back and think about that, because, for instance, in our household, my parents, my kids would kind of engage with my parents, but they would go and see them once a week, and a day a week they'd be with their grandparents. And so that's been really hard for my grandparents, or rather for my parents, because right now they're not doing that. But as a result, every single day, the kids have a time with their grandmother where they're learning a specific song that she's teaching them. They have a time every single day that they're doing prayers with the entire family now, and bringing together a larger family that probably didn't talk once a month at all at the same time. And now every single day at 7 o'clock on the dot, they're all there and they're all doing that together. We ordered the same kind of, we have this food box that ourselves and my sister-in-law and my wife's best friend have all ordered. And so they're getting the exact same food on Friday, and we're all going to cook it together on FaceTime. And yet usually we only talk to them once a month, and now we're talking to them every week, you know? And so if you take that list of top 10 people and you think about, okay, now I have the ability with no excuse and to be able to find a new way to reach out to them, at least during this period of time. And the great thing is that for, I don't know, the first time, at least in my life, everyone in the world is in the exact same position. We're all stuck at home. At least we should be. For those people who aren't stuck at home, you really should be thinking about staying at home right now. And so because of that, it's not like people have anywhere to go. I mean, my wife was saying the other day, well, at least I don't have any FOMO or fear of missing out, because there's nothing to miss out on, right? And so, again, come back to that list of 10 people. Think a little bit about how you can meaningfully engage, and then ask for help if you need it. I know that people are very hesitant about, you know, engaging with technology, but the reality is that people are now forced to do so. And if they just ask for help, we, you know, people can help you do that. I know that in Sherwood Park in Richmond, we're starting to find, you know, individuals and organizations that we can bring together to help people with technology or otherwise, because it's important that we help you bridge the gap on the small things that are easy for other people. But essentially, come back to like those top 10 people, how you can engage with them, and let's find a way. And if you can't think of how to engage them, pick up the phone and just call them and say, hey, I miss you. I'd love to find a way to connect. Can we every day chat at 1:30? And yeah, even if you just start with a phone call, you'd be surprised how many people aren't getting those phone calls that really would appreciate them. And so if you're thinking about them, just pick up the phone and say hello. And I think that'd be a good first step if you're, and you'll find that you'll feel a lot more connected in interesting ways.
That's so encouraging. Like, I, for me, just hearing that process is actually quite a paradigm shift, because yeah, it's easy to think about what you're, how you're not seeing everybody that you love. And now it's like, well, actually we're having, you know, my kids are FaceTiming more than ever. And it's so cool that we can actually have those conversations. So I'm actually going to stop the recording right now, because I don't want it to be too long for the people that want to join us. But I want to open it up for any questions. And for those of you that are shy and you have me on